Okay, good evening and welcome to Oscar J. Peterson Planetarium History Series. I'm Susie Aber, Director of the Science and Math Education Center and Peterson Planetarium. We are presently having a history series that we do nearly every Thursday since actually January of 2015, and it is focused on U.S. space exploration. So our series covers people, equipment, and spacecrafts needed to explore deep space and our own planet Earth. Telescopes are among the equipment used for observations and for science, and they can be ground or space-based observatories. And that's the topic of our special speaker tonight. Our speaker tonight, Melanie Kanoki, is an astronomer, and I'm going to say in her own words, she has studied the stars a long time before Pluto was no longer considered a planet. Melanie's been with the Columbia Public School Planetarium for, I think, 6 years?
Six or seven years,
and before that worked in various planetariums as public outreach coordinator since 1984. Some of the observatories she's been at: Mount Wilson in California, Lowell Observatory in Flagstaff, Arizona. She worked at Meade Instruments, writing instruction manuals for telescopes, and also with the Planetary Society, writing astronomy and space articles for their website. She has a bachelor's degree in physics. She has a master's degree in astronomy. Melanie has written 4 books. These include From Blue Moons to Black Holes and The Little Giant Book of Astronomy. And as a public planetarium director, she considers her job more astronomy outreach than a professional astronomer. And she said that her favorite part of the job is watching the kindergartners get excited and learn in the planetarium. So in 2014, she applied and became a NASA Airborne Astronomy Ambassador and was accepted into the program. In 2016, she flew aboard SOFIA, and she's going to tell us all about that. She and a teammate, also from the same high school where the planetarium is located, Rockbridge High School in Columbia, went with the rest of the team and again for a week or more up into the 747 specially fitted with an onboard telescope. She grew up in various places. Her parents actually live now in Kansas City. She moved to Missouri from California in 2005 with her husband, son, and the family dog. And you might remember, if you were at our February talk, we had Phil Kanoki, and that is no coincidence that they have the same last name. They are husband and wife. So if you remember that talk and you remember the hobby, one of the hobbies that Phil had, it was juggling. And this is a hobby that overlaps, and actually I think it's how they met each other, was juggling. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Melanie Kanoki.
I would like to thank you guys for coming, and I will talk a little bit about this really cool aircraft behind me. In 2014, like Susie was talking about, I got an email that came across my desk at the school that I'm working. It's through the NASA Museum Alliance. It is a really interesting database that NASA has set up that they provide museums, science centers, and teachers with all kinds of educational opportunities. They range from hearing web seminars to outreach opportunities. You can go to the different NASA facilities and go through workshops. Well, this one caught my eye because it was an opportunity to become a NASA Airborne Astronomy Ambassador. The Airborne Astronomy Ambassador, that sounded cool, that sounded interesting, but what I really wanted was the airplane. To become an Airborne Astronomy Ambassador, the ultimate goal of that is to fly on board SOFIA. Now, SOFIA I'll talk a little bit about that later, but basically it's a 747 that they cut a hole in and put a telescope in. So I applied with my partner. They required a team of two. One of them had to be a full-time teacher. The other one could be an informal educator. They have since changed the rules, so now it is primarily teachers. So I lucked out, I got in when I could. So now if you want to apply for this opportunity, you have to be a high school teacher right now. Before it was just a K through 12 teacher and an informal educator. They changed it, they are hopefully going to be changing it back. But you can find out about it on the NASA Airborne Astronomy Ambassador website. Let me back up a little bit. It's like, why would you want to put a telescope on an airplane? What's the deal? Well, we'll do a little science just to begin with. It has to do with the electromagnetic spectrum, the energy that we see. The visible light that you guys are looking at me at is just a very small amount of the energy that is being radiated into space from stars, from everywhere. It's called the electromagnetic spectrum, and it goes from the really long wavelengths, radio waves, through microwaves, infrared, visible light, ultraviolet, x-rays, gamma rays, cosmic rays. An example that I heard was if you stretched out the electromagnetic spectrum across our country, like 2,500 miles from the longest wavelengths to the shortest wavelengths, 2,500 miles, the visible portion that we see would be about an inch wide. So there's a tremendous amount of energy that's out there in the universe, and our eyes are only seeing a very small part of that. Now, why, oops, I keep forgetting this. This is such high tech stuff, I can't forget. Our eyes are cued to where we live, okay? Visible light makes it down through our atmosphere and we can see. Not a lot of the other radiation does. A lot of it gets stopped by our atmosphere. So this is above our atmosphere. As you come deeper, 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 you start getting things blocked out. Visible light makes it all the way through. Radio waves make it all the way through. But a lot of other stuff gets blocked out by our atmosphere. So infrared radiation gets absorbed as it comes in to our atmosphere by water vapor and carbon dioxide. And so if you can put an airplane above most of the atmosphere, above most of the water vapor in our atmosphere, you can still see a large amount of infrared radiation. And that's what Sophia does. It gets above 99.9% of all the water vapor in our atmosphere and allows astronomers to do infrared radiation observation. Now, why infrared? Why do we care? Well, okay, there's a lot of information out there that our eyeballs aren't seeing. This gives you a street scene. This is visible light at night. You can see the car headlights and a light here, building light. There's a street light here. The same view in infrared. You can see the car, but you're not seeing the headlights. You are seeing the heat that's radiating off, that's being emitted by the engine block. You are seeing the infrared radiation that is actually being emitted by the human bodies. We are at 98.6, okay? So infrared is heat, basically. So infrared, you can detect, you can actually see the humans. Over here, you can get a hint, but what you're seeing is light that's reflected off the humans. In the infrared view, you can see the foliage, the trees, okay? The trees are warmer than the surrounding area. So there's a lot of stuff out there that we aren't able to see with our eyes. You turn the telescopes outward and look up, the same thing. The left side is the night sky, where Orion is. Orion's up right now. You can see Orion about 8 o'clock, yeah, the time change messed me up. So this is you can see this tonight. This is what it looks like with infrared. All right, it's a tremendous difference. There's a lot of star-forming regions in the area of Orion. What you're seeing is the heat being emitted from interstellar sources that we can't see over here because that heat, that light is being blocked by clouds of gas and dust. The clouds of gas and dust block the visible light that we can see, but it allows the infrared heat to seep through. And so that's why you have all these hot spots here. So there's a lot out there that we can detect if you look with infrared. Now NASA has a history, it's History Month, so NASA has a history of putting telescopes on airplanes. They started out in 1968. They took a Learjet, and basically they just cleared out a spot, stuck a telescope by the door, and flew it to see if it was even feasible. This gives you an idea of scale here. This is a human. This white thing right here is the size of the telescope relative to the aircraft right here. And that's the opening that they used. It worked, so they graduated to a C-141 Starlifter that became known as the Kuiper Airborne Observatory. And that became active in 1975. And that flew for 20 years. They discovered the rings of Neptune. No, they discovered the rings of Uranus on Kuiper Airborne Observatory. Plus a lot of other discoveries. But they retired that in 1995. And at that point, they started talking about SOFIA. Now, they started talking about SOFIA in 1995. What caught my attention about the ad that came across my desk was SOFIA. In 1995, I actually interviewed for a job on SOFIA as a public outreach person. They flew me up to Ames Research Center, which is where it was based at the time. And I started asking questions like, well, when do I get to fly? And they said, oh, it's not scheduled to fly for 5 years. The position I was interviewing for was 2 years. It's like, why would I want a job promoting a plane that I wasn't going to get to fly in? So I declined, and I went my merry way. I did some lot of cool stuff, but SOFIA has always been in my back and on my radar, so to speak. It did not fly in 5 years. It did not fly until 2010. So it took a long time, a lot longer than they anticipated to get it up and running. But here is the human. Here's the 100-inch telescope, and this is the opening on the 747. SOFIA is a Boeing 747 SP. SP stands for Special Performance. It's shorter than most of the regular 747s, but it has the same size gas tank. So it doesn't hold as many people, but it'll take those fewer people a lot farther. This particular plane was christened the Clipper Lindbergh by Ann Morrow Lindbergh. Lindbergh's widow, on the 50th anniversary of Lindbergh's flight from the U.S. to France. It was rechristened It was christened by Eric Lindbergh when NASA bought it, and it was still christened the Clipper Lindbergh. You can see the name right here, Clipper Lindbergh. It flew for Pan Am several years. It flew a little bit for United. Before it was purchased by NASA. Now, what we did when we got there, it took us 2 years to fill out all the paperwork, to be accepted, to fill out more paperwork, and then send paperwork again that they lost. It took a lot of jumping through a lot of hoops to get out there. But when we finally got out there, we were given a pink badge, and that basically said, you can go. As long as you have a chaperone, you can go and just look. And it was a dream come true. You literally could just go wherever. As long as they had doors open, you could go wherever. This is my partner, the high school teacher that I went out with. This is Rex Belts. This is an overview of the plane. I will talk you through it. This is the I can't do this high tech stuff. I'm just gonna go over here. I give up. Come on. No, I broke it. All right, come on. There we go. Okay. So this is the pressurized part. This is where the instruments are. It does not look like a regular aircraft. They tore out all the chairs, and they put in consoles and computers and specialized chairs. Then there's a bulkhead. All right. This is the bulkhead that lies between the people and the telescope. And then the telescope behind that bulkhead, when they open that, it's basically a garage door. When they open the garage door, that telescope is out to the open to the elements. Like I said, it flies above most of the water vapor in our atmosphere. When they open the door, you can't tell. It is so smooth. They designed it aerodynamically that you can't tell that the door is open, except for a little flag on the screen that says the door's open. It's that smooth. One advantage of SOFIA is that you can fly wherever you need to. if there is a special event going on, like there was an occultation of Pluto that corresponded, it was like 2 weeks after New Horizons flew by Pluto, there was an occultation of Pluto and a star visible in Christchurch, New Zealand. They were able to fly Sophia down there, and it really a lot of maneuvering around, and they got to witness that. So that's something you can't do with a regular telescope. You can't pick your telescope up and a ground-based telescope and move it. So that was one advantage of Sophia. Okay, so when we got there, this was our first view of Sophia. You walk in the door, and this is looking towards the tail of the aircraft. The Stargate feature at the very back there, that's the bulkhead that blocks us from the telescope. The blue is the support for the telescope, and the light path comes through that. And then the things sitting up at an angle are the instrument and the counterweight and the electronics that support the instrumentation. The chairs in front here were our chairs. We, as Airborne Astronomy Ambassadors, actually had official seats. And that, I didn't think too much about the first night, but the second night we flew, it was pretty cool because they had visiting astronomers. They didn't have seats here. We had seats. So this is called the EPO station. The mission director and the mission director two were right in front of us. Beyond that was the science team. Over to the sides was another science station. This is where the science data came back. And over here is the telescope operators. And I was telling Susie, normally there's a line that is on that you cannot cross to get to the telescope. This is the telescope, the bulkhead. And this is the light path that's coming from the telescope into the instrumentation here. This was the day between our two flights, and this is the advantage of asking questions. All right, the scientist who developed this instrument here came back to us the first night and was basically giving us a lecture. He had his own PowerPoint computer, and he was talking about the detectors he was using that he helped construct. And evidently we impressed him because we were asking so many questions that he actually invited us back the next day to watch him take care of the instruments and prepare it for the flight. And in doing so, he allowed us to cross the line. And our chaperone, had flown 23 times on Sophia and never been allowed to cross the line. But if you ask a lot of questions to the right scientist, he'll let you cross the line. But this is just amazing. This feature here, this bulkhead, this goes all the way around, and I'm standing on a floor that stops right here. I'm like, toes are like right on the edge of the floor there, and then that circle continues all the way around. So that's the fuselage that you're seeing up there. That's the actual fuselage of the airplane, the outside skin of it. And this is the instrumentation. Great. So you have a 40-year-old aircraft, you have a 100-inch telescope, and you have a high-tech cutting-edge detector here. Let's see. This is what you were looking at. This is the bulkhead right here. Okay, I'm on this side with the instruments over here. The telescope is on the other side. We never saw the telescope, but the telescope is 100 inches. As somebody pointed out, this is a 100-inch ring. This is how big that telescope is. It is 4 inches bigger than the Hubble Space Telescope. And they put it on an aircraft. It is coated with aluminum. So the light or the infrared radiation from space comes in, it hits the telescope, bounces up to a secondary mirror, hits a third mirror. It's actually interesting because this is the first third mirror that reflects the infrared radiation into the light paths in the instruments. This is actually, they call it a dichroic mirror. It reflects infrared, but it allows visible light to go through. There's actually a second third mirror that bounces and goes out in a different path that allows them to visibly see what they're looking at. Sometimes there's a visible component to it. Sometimes there's not. Infrared, we can't detect it with our eyes. But we do have access to a visible light telescope. There's also two telescopes mounted on this part of the, or two cameras mounted on this part of the telescope for a different field of view optically. So we have three different ways of optically seeing where the telescope is pointed. This is an example of 100 inches. This was in the mirror processing facility. Basically, that's a shield they put around the mirror when they take it out of the aircraft so when they can wash it. They hadn't washed it yet. They hadn't resurfaced it yet. But the plan, that's what they're going to do. They have a plan. They just haven't had to redo it yet. This is the scientist that was really nice. He gave us a tour. You see some steam right here? It's not steam. That's liquid helium. Now, they have to cool the instrument quite a bit. Now, why? Because it's infrared. Infrared, we detect as heat, right? What do you get when you run electronics? You get heat. So if you're not careful and you're trying to detect heat, you're going to detect the heat that you're creating with your instruments. So to avoid that, they fill these big containers with liquid helium, and then on the other side there was a liquid nitrogen. So this thing gets really cold, and that allows them to make these detections from space. Now, we've got a 100-inch diameter telescope that is collecting as much infrared radiation as you can. When it comes to telescopes, I like to think of telescopes as light buckets, all right? Because you're trying to gather as much faint information as you can. So the bigger around your bucket, the more information you get. And then they take that information and they detect it with these guys here. Within this, this is kind of hard to see from my angle, but this is a ballpoint pen. This is a holder for some splinters. I mean, when I saw this, I thought I pulled splinters out of my finger that are bigger than that. Those are actually, the splinters are actually holders for the nanowires that they use to the detectors. So the detector is a nanowire. You've got a 100-inch diameter mirror and a nanowire detector. So you've got the really big and you've got the really super small. Well, why do you have super small? Because you're trying to detect very small amounts of heat coming from outer space. So you're looking at the heat from distant galaxies. It's going to be really, 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 really hard to detect. So you need a very small detector that can react to small amounts of heat. So that was the lecture that I was getting about. That's how we got to cross the line, because we were looking at these in these really incredibly small detectors. Okay, so that's the history, and that's the dynamics, and that's the mechanics of what we did. Then we got to do the fun stuff. We got to actually fly on the plane. Well, because it is an experimental aircraft, and it's owned by the federal government, it does not comply with FAA regulations. So basically, we had to go through some training because, you know, normal 747s, 200-300 people, well, this one holds about 25. And so at any given time, if something goes wrong, any one of those people are going to be required to do something, like open the door and have the emergency slide eject and do all these things. So we went through egress training, which we were really excited because we thought we would get to open the door and have the emergency slide go out. Turns out it costs $50,000 to every time you open the door and have that slide pop out. So we just got to watch a movie of some military guys having a lot of fun when they did pop the slide out. We learned how to do the radio. We learned how where our EPOS was. EPOS stands for Emergency Personal Oxygen Supply. We didn't have to sit down. We didn't have to have our seatbelts fastened. But if we were walking around, we had to carry our oxygen supply. It was just this little canvas bag with a plastic hood that you put over your head and a cartridge of oxygen. Not too heavy, but by 10 hours of hanging around your neck, it got to be pretty heavy. Then we got to do flight briefings. And during the flight briefing, this was the co-pilot here. He mentioned that they had a extra seat in the cockpit if one of the teachers wanted to go. And I got my hand up faster than anybody, and I kept my hand up, and I kept looking at the pilot. It's like, me, me, me. And so I got to fly in the cockpit of the aircraft, and I wasn't sorry that I beat everybody else up. This was one of the flight paths for the first night. We flew over 14 states. We almost flew up into Canada, so we had to have our passports just in case we went into Canada and something happened. We took off from California. Aircraft is based at Palmdale, and so we flew over California, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, Nebraska, up to Minnesota, down and back. Now, for every hour that we fly, it takes 10 hours of preparation to do. Because what you're trying to do is you're trying to observe a particular object, and the telescope is on one side of the aircraft. So you have to plan your path so that you can actually get home. So you have to plan, if you're gonna look over here, you have to be over, the plane has to be flying here. If you wanna look over there, you're gonna have to turn the plane. Okay, then you probably need to go that way, so you're gonna have to look at something over there. And then you have to figure out, okay, well, I need to start turning around. Orion is a really popular target for the infrared telescope. Unfortunately, you can't look at Orion all the time or you'd end up flying around the world. So what they have to do is they have to balance it, most at Orion, and then you have to find objects in the other part of the sky so that you can get back home again. Every flight path is different. The weird shaped things, there's some yellow paths and there's some pink paths, those are military no-fly zones. And so another thing that has to go into this, another consideration is, somebody has to get on the line and call and make sure that, are those hotspots gonna be active at the time we fly over? So it gets pretty complicated. The second night, you're not supposed to fly two nights in a row, unless you're a scientist that have the telescope for 4 days. But pilots and staff cannot fly two nights in a row. So they do it every other night. So we flew along with the same team. We flew on a Monday night and a Wednesday night. And so the Wednesday night, we flew out over the ocean. For me, it was really cool. I lived in LA for 10 years, and we flew right over Catalina Island on our way out. That was neat to see. This is after our flight briefing, we go back to the plane. And then they have another briefing. They call roll call. If your name's not on the manifest, you're not on the plane. If you're on the manifest and you don't make the plane, by the time they shut the door, you don't come. They keep track of who all's there, who all's not. Then they do a flight briefing like, all right, don't burn the coffee. If you burn the coffee, that fills the cockpit with smoke and we come back down. Don't throw anything down the toilet because a clogged toilet will cancel a flight. Tripping hazards, yes, there will be tripping hazards. There are wires, so just don't trip over them. Things like that, they allowed you to use your brain. Now, why do they have wires? Because those belong to the headphones of the flight safety officers. We did not have flight attendants on this flight. These are the only regular airline seats that they have on this aircraft. The others have been torn out and other seats have been put in at the consoles. But the flight safety officers have to have headphones. Now, why not they use wireless headphones? Well, because that would interfere with the detectors. They had a galley that had microwaves. We could not use the microwaves because that would interfere with the detectors. At one point, I was standing up near the telescope, as close as I could get to the telescope during flight. And I was using my camera to take a movie of the telescope as it appeared to move up and down. And the scientists got up and they were looking around and they said, there's some interference. Somebody's got a device that is interfering with our data. And I was really nervous because I was right up there. But they took one look at my camera, my old camera, and they laughed. Like, you're fine. So they were looking for some high-tech thing. My partner brought his iPad, his iPhone, and he was going to use all those, but he couldn't use any of them. So my old camera that they were laughing at was the only reason that I got pictures. So anyway, they had the headphones on with the ears. So this is me. I was up in the cockpit of the 747. Again, it's a 40-year-old aircraft. Actually, it turns 40, I think, next year. The flight engineer is sitting. You can just see his back. I didn't know what a flight engineer did. I thought they had something to do with maps. Well, it turns out he does just about everything but fly the plane. The pilots, and actually, when they were taken off, the flight engineer's chair turns around and pushes forward, and he had his hands on the throttle. He was controlling the engines during takeoff. So all three of those men were flying the plane when it took off. This is the flight engineer station. He controls the galley. They were having some issues with the oil pressure dropping, and he had to flip the galley switch a couple times to get the oil pressure for the engines. Magic was used a couple of times, they said, but they got it to work. This is just the circuit breakers for the aircraft. And they would stand and stare at the circuit breakers for a while trying to figure it out. And this is me. I wasn't having any fun during the thing. This shows what it was like during the flight. It's just a little clip here. Come on, you worked. There we go. Okay. So you can see that they keep the lights on at this level. Everybody has their headphones. It was kind of loud. That's why everybody has their headphones. It was just this constant noise. It's louder than a normal aircraft. It's also colder than a normal aircraft. We got these jackets, and I thought that was pretty cool. Well, there's a reason they give you these jackets, because it is cold on the aircraft. The instrument that we flew with was called GRAIT. It's the German receiver for astronomy at terahertz frequencies. It's an awkward acronym, but I think they just did it so they could say that they were great astronomers. That one is particularly sensitive to the ambient temperature, so they kept the cabin even colder than they normally do. So it was 60 degrees, which doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're in the airplane for 10 hours and you're not moving a whole lot, it does get a little cold. This is some of the information that we saw. We had screens at our station. It's a lot of data here, a lot more than you ever really want to know, actually. But this tells you the target and what we were looking at and the location. It tells you the leg of the flight. Everybody had those flight paths that they passed out, everybody, pilots and all the scientists and everybody, to keep track of where they were. These are various indicators of where the telescope is. The telescope could move up and down about 60 degrees. So there was a lot of movement in this particular axis. It could move about 2.5 degrees from side to side, and then it could rotate just a little bit as well. And so depending on which graph you see, it shows the orientation of the telescope. And then I learned that this over here was the compass. I learned that as we were taxiing in the last leg of the trip. And I thought, you know, it'd been nice if I'd known that was a compass before. But this indicates that the door is open to the telescope. When the door closes, the gray screen comes down. And that's the only indication that you have that the telescope is involved. It's really kind of strange. This is the telescope operator station. It took two guys and all of those computers to control the telescope. Because it's just as complicated as it sounds. And most of the time, there is not a visual component to what they're looking at, because they're looking at infrared. But for this one, they're looking at the Orion Nebula, and you can see it up here. So they're looking at a region of the Orion Nebula. And this is infrared radiation, so there's not always a visible component, and we don't get pretty pictures. Oh, I jumped ahead. This is during an observation run. What I want you to do is I want you to watch this part, because we're trying to show you how the telescope looks like it's moving relative to the aircraft. So I'm going to run it a couple of times, because it's a short clip. It's one of those things, I was holding it so I was moving, and then the plane was moving, and also the telescope had moved quite a lot, and then I would pick up my camera to take a picture and everything would go quiet. And then I put my camera down and it would move again. And so it's like I took about 10 minutes worth of movies and this is the best shot I got. But the strange thing is, the telescope is not what's moving, it's the airplane. The telescope, this entity right here, is locked onto a target object and it's not moving. It's being held in place by gyroscopes. What you see, this movement here, is actually the airplane that's bouncing around it. So all the turbulence that we go through was bouncing, and it looked like the telescope was moving. This is one of the scientists that came and gave our, this is two of the other teachers that were on board with me. There were a total of five teachers on board. And two of them I know are from Kansas City. And so I think they are giving a talk at this Kansas City Science Center. But they're not in this picture. The scientists came up back and they talked with us, they shared with us. This guy was talking about how the information that they had just received disproved his theory, but there's a gas cloud that's above the Milky Way and it's falling back into the plane of the Milky Way, and they're trying to figure out if this is new gas or if this is old gas. And he didn't really like the data that they got. So is he going to change his theory? I don't know. He was talking to my partner about that, but I thought it was funny. You know, you have a beautiful hypothesis, and it can be ruined by one little truth. You know, And this is the data we got. Okay, we didn't get pretty pictures. We got peaks in the data. And this was, I think, evidence of carbon 2, which is a an effect of the cooling. As stars form, the cloud of gas heats up, and if it heats up too much, then it stops the contraction, and stellar formation doesn't occur. So as a cloud contracts, it has to have a way to cool off so it can continue to contract. And they were looking for carbon 2, which is an indicator of a certain cooling process, and they found it in this particular batch. I think this was the Orion Nebula area. And so that is pretty much it. I think there's one more thing. Yeah, I wanted to talk just a little bit about this. I mentioned that they flew it to Christchurch, New Zealand. And at one point they viewed the occultation of Pluto. And this is a really interesting flight path that they did. Basically, what they did is they took off from Christchurch, and while they were flying, they were in touch with people in Chile and in Flagstaff, Arizona, using a satellite phone to find out, because they were able to observe Pluto and the star Pluto was going to occult. They were observing it live in South America and getting updates. Then they were sending them to Flagstaff, and then they were calling on the phone to Christchurch. And they realized at this point that they were going to be way early. So they had to adjust their course. And then they were tracking on Pluto, and then they realized here that it was going to be way early. They were still going to be early, so they did a trombone maneuver, which just basically ate up time. And they got back on track. And then here, they realized they were still a little too early. So they killed some time, made this little bump, got right back on track, and they crossed over the exact point. This is where Pluto occulted the star, and they were dead on. But it took, they had planned this for 3 years, and they were still changing their course up until the last hour, and then they managed to get it. And that's something you can't do with a stationary telescope. Although, ironically, there were a couple of telescopes that were pretty close to the center point on New Zealand. One of them was clouded out. They got the first half of the data, and then clouds came in. So you don't have to worry about clouds when you're up at 45,000 feet. So that's one advantage of having an airborne telescope. Another advantage is that you can change the instruments. There are 8 different instruments that can be attached to SOFIA. If one of them breaks, they can fix it and put it back on it. If a space telescope breaks, it's gone. The Hubble, they could repair it. They repaired it, I think, 6 times. They had servicing missions, but now we don't have a shuttle, so we can't repair the Hubble anymore. So when the Hubble dies, it dies for good this time. There's a new telescope called the James Webb Infrared Telescope that's getting ready to launch in 2018. That is going to actually deploy on the other side of the moon. That deploys, and everything works, that's great. If it doesn't, it's not. So there's several advantages of having this telescope. It's not cheap. It is very complicated and very expensive to keep working, but it is a lot of fun. And they do get good data. When everything works, it's a lot of fun. So that's my talk. I don't know if anyone has any questions. This was the last picture. This was our last day there. If anybody is an original Star Trek fan, you might recognize Gorn territory. But I like to call this our landing party shot.
Where's the Gorn?
He's gone. He's the one taking the picture.
With his sunny green fingers.
Yeah. Actually, my husband and 2 friends went up there. This is Vasquez Rocks, which is just north of L.A., not too far from Palmdale, where we were at. And he and his friends set up a camera, and it took all day for them to do, each of them do the Kirk run, where he's a communicator, and then he turns and runs up the rocks, and so they each have their own. But, people kept getting in the way and all this, so That's what aerospace engineers do on their day off. They go play with
one. If we turn to the first slide, I've got some.
The first slide?
One of the first ones. One that showed the various windows.
Sorry. We'll get there.
It's early.
The first one.
No. Let's go forward to, that one.
This one, okay.
Okay, so you're flying a 45,000 feet, a little airplane there.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like there are some wavelengths you're still not getting that you'd like to.
Right, there, let me just, I have my cheat sheet here. That shows the different wavelengths.
It would be great if you could get up to where that little,
Yeah, it would be. The aircraft, the 747 SP, the maximum altitude is 45,100 feet. At least that's what they say. And so that's as high as they can go. And
I'm just wondering what you get from that.
From that extra.
From the ground. And then, of course, obviously satellites can see anything, but
right.
They cost more, so.
Well, they cost more. I don't know that they really cost more, because Sophia is kind of expensive, but the problem with satellites is that they have a very limited lifetime, and if something goes wrong, we can't fix them, like I said.
I'm trying to figure what wavelengths you're getting that you can't get from the ground, and we'll just forget about satellites.
Okay.
In this question.
Oh, where is
it?
I took it
out.
Well,
some of that comes down from the ground. You see?
Okay.
The infrared near visible does come down
from the mountain. Right, and there is a near visible that can be seen from the ground. And my friends at Mount Wilson, and they're doing, it's CHARA. I don't know what CHARA stands for, but it's out of the university in Georgia. And they are doing infrared interferometry. So they're using several different telescopes to pull it together. And they're doing that on Mount Wilson. And it is the near infrared. So this goes out to like 500 micrometers. I don't know if you can see this. I don't have this online. So there are different wavelengths. So there is a wall that they can't go up, and that's probably what you're seeing there. I don't know how much more, but it's pretty close to the end of the infrared spectrum, and then it goes on into the microwaves. So I guess I don't know the answer to that question. I don't know what would be gained by it. But I know that they max out they go to the maximum altitude that the 747 can go.
So. You mentioned how they cryogenically cool the detectors themselves.
Uh-huh.
Is the actual mirrors cooled as well?
No. The mirror is open to the elements. Those little slivers are what's cooled. And there are 14 detectors. They're 7 locations, and each one is looking in one direction and another direction, so they can polarize. So it's like a circle with one in the center. And that's the layout of the detectors. That's the only thing that's cool. The telescope at 45,000 feet, it was minus 81 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's cool just because it's cool outside.
That's cool enough that the mirrors don't really interfere with the heat that they don't give off their own heat? Or is that like always factored out?
It's engineered. A question was, well, what about the heat from the engines? But it's the way they engineered it and the way that they have the baffles they have on the outside of the aircraft. You really can't see it in this one, but there's a rise on either side. And it rises up, and that allows the air to flow over and down. And then inside the telescope cavity, there are also baffles that keep the air from getting in, and it maintains the thermal equilibrium. So, and the telescope itself is made out of a material called ZeroDur, Z-E-R-O-D-U-R, and I think that's like thermally fairly stable. So it, they don't seem to have a lot of problems with the dynamics of the changing temperatures. And it's also extremely efficient. So like within 20 minutes of getting in the air, they're observing. And within 20 minutes of the last observation, the telescope is parked and we are on the ground. They said that they have discussions on how they can shave off a second here or a second there by doing a procedure slightly differently. So they are constantly working on being as efficient as possible. And like I said, so it takes 10 hours of planning for each 1 hour of flight time.
So during those 10-hour flights, like when you mentioned the Christchurch and stuff, do they close the doors again, or do they just have that thing staring off?
They just have it. They have it going all the time. It's staring out. Now, what? Let's see. The first night we went, they forgot to open the light path, so they were essentially telescope is open. They couldn't figure out why they weren't getting any data because somebody forgot to take the kite cover off. The camera lens. They forgot to open the camera lens, and so I think somebody owed somebody a beer. But that was like 10 minutes of lost data. Then the second night, the Germans had, we were flying with a great instrument, so there were a lot of Germans on board. And the second night, for some reason, during the pre-flight briefing, the German says, well, we've changed some of the targets. And the crew went, you did what? Like, oh, no problem, no problem. It's like, no problem. The, you know, different targets, different tracking stars and stuff. So they the telescope operators the second night literally were observing on the fly. They had books open and they had different computers trying to find different targets for different tracking stars for the different targets they were looking at. And at one point, the telescope got away from them. The flight director's like, I lost the telescope. It's like, well, technically you didn't lose the telescope. The telescope's still attached to the plane, but they just lost what they were looking at. And they had to go through kind of a reboot. But if you think about it, it's traveling over 500 miles an hour, and they're trying to track on one object, and they've got to keep it steady. You know, and it's just kind of mind-boggling that they can do that. But they did.
So you had seats, actually, console that you sat at. Were you,
I did.
Were you actually looking at something in particular, or were you just there as an observer to do the altitude?
Our job, our job as airborne astronomy ambassadors was to observe. And to talk to people and to figure out what makes Sophia tick. At first, I was really nervous about being an educator and all around all these scientists. I wasn't, and I'm not even a teacher, I'm an informal educator. I'm just a planetarian person. Just a planetarian person.
That's all right, there's a lot of them.
But I realized, I felt like I was invading their space, but I realized. After the end of the first night, I realized that Sophia is an airplane. It's not the people on board. The people on board come from a wide variety of backgrounds. The co-pilot, it was only his second night on Sophia. He was as psyched to be on Sophia as I was. The flight director had flown over 100 flights. He was still really psyched to be on Sophia for the opportunity to fly. Telescope operators were so jazzed to be able to do this. So, and the scientists were really excited to be on board because they finally got to get to do some observing. So Sophia is this airplane, and it's an umbrella that draws a whole bunch of different people under its cover, and everybody was so excited. And so I, after the end of the first flight, I didn't really feel like I was invading anybody's space. I felt like I was a team that was part of the experience. And then the second night, when the first night was just solo German, it was just the German astronomers that had their time on their aircraft or on their instrument. The second night, there were visiting observers that had petitioned and applied for observing time. Well, these guys had to sit up front. They didn't have any place to sit, and they didn't know where to plug in your headphones. So suddenly, we weren't the newbies. I'm like, I can show you. I know what I'm doing. You know, so I felt like I was really part of the team. But the idea of the ambassador program is to get you excited about it, or to get the teachers excited about it, and then to go back to the students or go back to the public and to say, hey, you know, everybody wants to be an astronaut, but there are very, very limited number of astronauts. But there's a lot of other cool jobs you can do and still work for NASA. You can be a pilot, you can be a computer engineer, you can be a telescope operator, you can be a flight safety officer, you can do all kinds of things and still have a really cool job. Yeah.
You know if they have any plans to use this observatory in this area on August 21st when we have the solar?
I know that the, I know that at least the professor from MU is talking with one of the people at SOFIA to try to get them to do something with the eclipse. I have not heard.
I think it'd be very interesting to be able to observe that at 40,000 feet. You think you'd have a different perspective?
Just fly the totality line as it happens.
Yeah. the reality is, I don't think that's going to happen. I mean, but people are trying. But SOFIA is, I mean, it's an expensive device. Also, I'm not sure how. I guess it depends on what instrument you put. See, one of the advantages is you can change out all kinds of instruments. You can put out all kinds of different instruments on there. So I don't know, but I do know that people are talking about it, that it has come up, and people are lobbying for that. I don't know what the outcome is. I personally doubt that anything is going to happen, but yeah, it's worth a shot. People are trying.
Do you know what they were specifically looking for with the occultation of Pluto? Were they looking for an atmosphere?
It was totally to determine the composition of Pluto's atmosphere.
Okay.
And honestly, I listened to the talk twice, and I still don't totally understand how the physics of that works. But what they do is, if Pluto, let me see. All right, let's say that this is the star, and this is Pluto, and my hand's going to pass in front of it. If Pluto was just a rock in space, you know this, right? The rock would just block out the star, and the star would reappear, and there would be no dimming and gradual brightening. But if Pluto has an atmosphere that extends out, as that atmosphere starts to interact with the star will gradually fade away. And then when the planet blocks it, it'll disappear. And then on the other side, it's going to come out. It will appear slightly through the thicker atmosphere. And then as it moves away, it's going to move through thinner and thinner atmosphere. So that gives you an idea of the composition of the atmosphere. And they were really successful in all of their navigation to get it right on the center line, so it passed almost directly across the center of Pluto. And it also corresponded, it happened 2 weeks after New Horizons flew by Pluto, so they had visual data, they had all kinds of data that they got by the close encounter, and they were able to correlate that with the occultation data. And they are, like, papers are imminent. They have been working for 2 years to get these papers, and they are very, very close to being published. So anytime now they're going to be releasing these papers about the Pluto atmosphere.
Is SOFIA sensitive enough to detect atmospheres on extrasolar planets? Have they been able to do that or talk about that?
I don't know that answer. I know that the recent announcement of the TRAPPIST-1 star system with seven Earth-sized planets, that was done in the infrared, and that was done using the telescope that I'm just blanking on. There's a Chile one, but there's another one that's in orbit. It's actually orbiting
Kepler.
Yes, it's the warm period of the Kepler mission. Is it Kepler? That may or may not be. Anyway, there's an observatory that's actually trailing Earth, and that telescope is infrared, and they were able to observe that particular star for 500 hours solid, which is not something you can usually do, because with Hubble, you've got sunrise and sunset, and so you can look for a little bit, and then the sun goes down, and then the sun is up, and then you can. So this was 500 hours of solid observation around that particular star, and that was done in infrared, and they got some really cool data back, and that's why they were able to fairly accurately say that they found seven planets. I do not know if the resolution on SOFIA would be enough to do that. I don't know that. I should, but I don't.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I think you're a wonderful ambassador, and I'm really pleased that we had such a quality crowd here tonight that was interested, so thank you.